Angels, part two. As I continue teaching you guys, remember we talked about the kingdom of God. Now we're talking and I'm teaching you all on the kingdom of heaven. And we're just getting going on the kingdom of heaven. But this is the angels of God who are a part of the kingdom of heaven. And the Bible's role that they say that angels play within our lives. I want to give you just a quick little review. The kingdom of heaven, that's you and I there at the bottom, that little stick man or stick woman. And that kingdom of heaven is your vertical relationship. That's your relationship to God the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. Everyone say amen. And then not only do you have a vertical relationship, but then you have to deal with people. Some people say, ugh. Listen, I had a friend of mine, actually Doc Westbrook, I don't know how many of y'all know him, but he's 90 now, but back when I was a kid and just starting off in the ministry, he told me once, he said, Brother Bruce, he said, church is wonderful and would really be great if it only had no people. And what he was talking about is you have to deal with human beings. How many of you know that if you work in a workplace, you have human beings that you deal with? Some people are easy to get along with. How many of you know some people are what? A little more difficult, take a little more patience to get along with. Well, listen, guys, that's our horizontal relationship. We have the relationship with God the Father, but that's not enough. The Bible says not only do we have to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, but we have to love our neighbor as what? Have to love our neighbor as ourself. The angels of the kingdom of heaven. Amen. And that's why I want to talk to you. And the first thing I want to do is review a little bit about last week. I said to you guys that believers believe more in the demonic world than they do the angelic. Now, this doesn't make a lot of sense. You talk to believers, and they're like, oh, you know, the devil's got me down, and demons been pouncing on my family, and this and that. But you never hear believers mention the angels of God, hardly at all, except at Christmas time. Listen, guys, when you read through the New Testament, there's over 71 instances of angel visitations and angelic interactions with human beings. Someone say amen. We said last week that angels could be loosed by believers. Amen. As we pray to the Father and pray and loose the angels of God. When I was praying over my wife and son, I was praying to the Father for the angels of God to go before them and behind them, preparing their way. Amen. Angels, the scripture says, rejoice at the salvation of a single soul. What does that mean? That means when somebody commits and surrenders their life to Jesus, the angels of heaven have a throwdown. Now, if they were Texas angels, they'd have a hoedown. But they have a throwdown. I mean, they just are rejoicing at just the salvation of a single soul. You and I need to understand this. The Bible teaches us this. The angels of heaven, the Bible says, are sent to serve those who have surrendered their life to the Lord. If you're here today and you've surrendered your life to the Lord, God has appointed angels over you and your home and your family. I don't know about you, but I think that's a beautiful thing. Amen? The angels of heaven are messengers of the Father to answer prayer. Now listen, and this is so important. I want you to hear this. God doesn't need angels. God is God. He has need of nothing. He doesn't need people, but He wants to use angels to accomplish His purpose, and He wants to use human beings to accomplish His person, His purposes, amen? And throughout the Scripture, Old and New Testaments, throughout the entire Bible, from Genesis through Revelation, you find time and time again where angels in heaven are sent as messengers from the Father to answer prayer, not just in the Old Testament, but in the New Testament as well. We said that the angels of heaven are created beings. Okay, God created them. He created them before the earth was created. Because the scripture in Psalms, it says that the angels rejoiced when God laid, in the book of Job, it says the angels rejoiced when God laid the foundations of the earth. That means they had to be there or they couldn't have rejoiced. Amen? The angels of heaven are an angelic army. How many of you kids remember playing with your army men? I used to have little green army men. I know they're not too popular anymore. but I'd set them, I'd spend hours setting them up, and I'd take marbles and just... Listen, the angels of heaven are an angelic army, not to fight human beings, but they war against the principalities, the powers of darkness, the rulers of this world who seek to destroy the things of God. That's who their fight is with. All right. Now you can catch that message on YouTube. That was just a review. Now we're going to start in on new stuff. The story of the invisible. Everyone say the invisible. Invisible means you can't see it. Amen? Now, it's funny that here we are in the year 2016, and you mention God or things of God to some people, and they're like, they kind of laugh and scoff because they can't see it. Yet you ask them to plug into Wi-Fi that they can't see either, and they're like, no problem. You ask them to take a deep breath. All those oxygen molecules, those ions with electrons, which you can't see, they have no problem with that. Listen, guys, we need to boost our faith in these last days because God's heaven is invisible to your naked eye, but it's more real than the things that you and I see. Angels can disguise themselves as human beings. Now, the Bible teaches this. Now, this is kind of an unusual thing. Angels, you know, we think of angels, and you saw the picture, we think of, you know, the Bible describes some angels as being like 8 foot tall, and we think of huge wings, and of course, Hollywood's helped our image of angels. And also, you ever go into one of those little consignment shop ladies, the little thrift store, and you see those little figurines of angels? You ever see angel figurines? Most of that's not based on anything in the Bible. It's just based on somebody's concept and artwork that they did. But listen, the Bible teaches here in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2, it says, "Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some have unwittingly entertained" who? Angels. Wow. Now, this doesn't mean to just start going out and picking up every hitchhiker unless the Holy Spirit tells you to. You know, back in the day, it used to be, you know, no big deal to pick up hitchhikers. Now it's a totally different story in the year 2017. Listen, my pastor told me a story about a time where he literally picked up a stranger and was talking to him, and then he stopped and he turned around. This guy had literally disappeared, just was gone. And this was coming from somebody I know. I've heard that as well, a similar story from another pastor. Listen, the scripture, how many of you know that the Bible's true? And it says, don't forget to entertain strangers. I wonder how many angelic beings have come along your path to see how you would react or how you would respond to them. It's an interesting thought, isn't it? This is a New Testament. Don't forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some have unwittingly entertained angels. Now, the main thing I want to talk to you about this morning is angels guard and protect God's people. How many of you like that? How many of you have ever had a situation in your life where you believe that an angel of God somehow spared you from a car accident, from serious injury, something of that nature? Raise your hand. Look around. Leave your hand lifted. Y'all look around. Now listen to me. You can put them down. Angels are sent to guard and protect the people of God who have surrendered to Him. Amen. Now, I want to show you, and we're going to be in the scripture most of the morning. This is Psalms 34, verse 7 and 8. It says, "The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear Him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in Him." The first part of this says the angel of the Lord encamps. Everyone say encamps. All around those. Now I want to give you a little Hebrew here. Okay? That word for encamps is shana. It means to pitch a tent, generally to encamp for abode. Literally to be shade and protection for His people from the sun of the wilderness. You know what I think of? I think of this. I think of the angels of God. When you surrendered your life to Jesus, they pitch a spiritual tent of protection all around your life and all around the lives of your family. Someone say amen. Isn't that good news? Then it goes on. And not only that, but if you were living in the wilderness and the sun were beating down on you at 105, 110, 115 degrees. You ever been in that high heat here in Abilene sometimes? A little shade would give you a little comfort. Sometimes it's 15 degrees, 20 degrees cooler in the shade. So I think of the angels of God as they come to encamp around God's people. They come to bring them shade, not physical shade, but spiritual shade, some comfort in the times of their trials of their life. Amen. I can tell you I've heard more stories about the angels of God who have come and shown up in prisons where Christians were. We have a Tiffany. You want, ma'am, would you mind if you went with her to the nursery for a few minutes?
Okay.
That'd be okay? We have a beautiful nursery. And Tiffany's in charge of our little babies, and she'll do a great job. All right, guys. So listen, the tent of to encamp is literally this tent of protection around about the people of God. Amen? Angels guard and protect God's people. Guard and protect God's people. Back in Psalm 34, verse 7 and 8, the angel of the Lord encamps all around. Everyone say all around. All around those who fear him and delivers them. All around. That word all around in the Hebrew is sabib. Everybody say sabib.
Sabib.
See, you didn't know you were going to learn Hebrew this morning. Sabib means to circle, to revolve around, or to border. And here I think of the angels of God. They're not just all around us. They're circling all around your life, throughout your life. Amen? Bringing protection, bringing protection, bringing a guard in your life. I wonder how many of God's people, the angels of God protect, that don't even ever think and realize that the angels are even there. Now, I'm not like some, and I'm not, you know, there's people off into weird things with everything in the scripture. How many of you know that? They're off into angel worship, and they're off into all kinds of crazy stuff. But listen, angels do interact with human beings. The Bible teaches that. They come as messengers and actually give messages to God's people. As long as you know it's an angel and not a demon. Now, how do you know the difference? The Apostle Paul said, even if an angel comes teaching you a different gospel than I've brought, let him be accursed. Anathema. So listen, there was a guy one time, I want you to hear this story. We were living in an apartment complex, and there was a guy who had passed out flyers to this whole apartment complex that he was going to start holding this New Age meeting, and we wanted to go and share Jesus with this fellow. And so myself and my two associate ministers went with me, and we went, and we're the only ones that showed up. So we got to talk to him about the Lord, but what was funny is he was talking about this stuff, and he says, He said, an archangel Gabriel appeared to me and said this, this, and this. The only problem was that this, this, and this, I can't remember specifics, were contrary to what the Bible says. Opposite. Are you following me? So I asked him, how did you know that it was the archangel Gabriel? And he said, well, it looked like him. I said, well, what's he look like? And this is what he said. He looks like what's in your Bible, the pictures in your Bible. I said, my Bible has no pictures. So then we began to talk to him about being careful. And listen, you have to have discernment. Just because some supernatural entity speaks to you, you've got to know it comes from God. Amen. How do you know? The scripture, the Bible, the Bible, the Bible, the Bible is your foundation. Everybody say, the Bible is my foundation. Look at your neighbor, say, the Bible is your foundation. Listen, The angels of God are protecting our borders of your life. They're protecting what comes in and what can't come in. I need that in my life. Amen. How many of you know when you're on the front lines of battle, you know, there, back in the day in World War II, as we were going to battle the Americans against the Japanese in Okinawa, they told the medics to take off their first aid cross sign because they said that they were the first guys to go because the enemy would look for them and kill them this way that if people got wounded or whatever, they would just die. They wouldn't be able to get fixed up. Listen, if you're out there on the front lines doing a work for God, you've got a bullseye on your chest. But that's okay. Why? Because we've got the angels of God protecting our borders and protecting what comes in. Amen? Amen. Turning the ugly into lovely. Now, I love this. Only God can turn ugly into lovely. Amen? Now, I'm not talking physical appearance. We'll leave that to makeover shows, all right? Turning the ugly into lovely. Angels participate in making all things that come into our life work for His purpose. I love that. You know, there's a scripture in Romans 8, 26 through 28. It says, likewise, in verse 26, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. How many of you have weaknesses? Amen? Like I say, if I were an octopus, I'd have all 8 arms up, okay? The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought to pray. Have you ever had a situation that came up and you just weren't sure how to pray? The Holy Spirit of God will assist you and help you with that. It says, but the Spirit Himself intercedes, prays on your behalf with groanings too deep for words. And He who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes, prays on behalf of the saints according to the will of God. And the key verse is verse 28. And we know, everyone say, we know. We know. Look at your neighbor, say, I know. That for those who love God, all things work together for what? For good. For those who are called according to His purpose. Well, who helps to make that happen? And the Holy Spirit. Yes, it's the Holy Spirit, but you have to understand that the Holy Spirit, God the Father, He works through angelic hosts, and He also works through other human beings. So God can even use other people to bring blessings to your life when you're going through difficult situations. Amen. Why? Because God can work through anyone He wants to use. In the Old Testament, He walked through a donkey. Remember the story of Balaam? Balaam was going to go off and do his own thing. He's riding on that donkey. That donkey, like Sammy's story, sees that angel and he doesn't move. And so Balaam starts to beat that poor donkey, whooping him and kicking him and just tearing him up. And finally, God opened the mouth of the donkey. I wish I'd been just able to see that. Opened the mouth of the donkey and said, Balaam, why are you beating me? And Balaam, you'd think he would have been astonished. Why is my donkey talking to me? But he's so frustrated at the donkey, they says, it's because you won't move. He says, look, you've been my owner, the donkey says, for all these years. Have I ever done this to you? He said, no. And suddenly the Bible says that Balaam's eyes were open and he saw an angel in his path with a flaming sword. That angel was fixing to remove his head from his shoulders. And that donkey saved his life. So listen to me. God can use the things around us for our good. Amen? Amen. Angels guard and protect God's people. Back to Psalm 34, 7 and 8. It says, the angel of the Lord encamps. He's like a tent set up over believers all around, circling, guarding, keeping bad things from happening, coming into your life. And then it says, those who fear Him and delivers them. Everyone say delivers. Delivers them. I love this. Listen to me. Delivers in Hebrew is shalat. Everybody say shalat. To rescue. How many of you ever need rescuing in your life? How many of you ever need emotional rescuing? Mental rescuing, physical rescue, all the above. Amen. Shalat delivers them to rescue, to draw out a victory or to bring forth a victory. Also means to strip away. Listen, God uses the angels of God to help bring victory at times into your life. Amen. Now, I don't know about you, but it's much more enjoyable to walk in the kingdom of God victorious and as an overcomer than always walking around defeated and undergoing. Did you know you could have terrible circumstances happening in your life and still be an overcomer? I am not talking about the circumstances of your life always being good. The Bible does not teach that. Some churches do, but the Bible does not teach that. I'm talking about regardless of the circumstances of our life, where you can walk as an overcomer in the victory that Jesus has given to you as a believer in the Messiah. Someone say amen. Amen. Angels strip away bonds, both spiritual and natural. Angels can draw us out of what is hindering us and help us to win. Now, we live in a very competitive culture. How many of you have ever played a game to lose? No, you play to what? You play to win. Well, listen, we've read the end of the book. Someone say amen. We know how it ends. Hallelujah. So you and I have to understand that the angels of God are at work in our families, in our lives, because God has asked them to come and to help bring victory to our lives and to help strip away those things that hinder us. How many of you ever have things that hinder you? It may be entertainment. It may be just whatever. God wants to help strip those things away to draw you to Himself. Amen? And the angels of God can assist and do assist Him and help Him. Also, physical bonds. Again, sometimes people are in situations where they need supernatural, miraculous, angelic visitation to bring salvation, to bring physical release to them, like Peter in prison. I want to talk about that with you. The story of angelic deliverance. Acts chapter 12. And we're going to close with this story. Acts 12, 4 through 10. So when he had arrested him, he put him in prison. Now, in context, it's talking about Peter. He had been arrested, and he's put in prison. And delivered him to four squads of soldiers. Everyone say four squads of soldiers. Four squads. So I want you to picture this for a minute. Peter the apostle, he's been arrested. He's been placed into a jail cell. And that's not bad enough. There's four squads of soldiers hanging out in front of the jail. I want you to picture this in your mind, okay? Four squads, not four soldiers, four squads of soldiers. I mean, this fellow was intent on making sure that Peter the apostle stayed in prison. Did you know that God can foil the best made plans of man? And it doesn't take him but a heartbeat, but a moment to do. Amen? Again, he can foil the best plans that Satan has to try to bring ruin to a believer's life. God can take that and foil it in a heartbeat and turn it around for that believer's good. And he does all the time. Amen? Oh, so four squads of soldiers to keep him, intending to bring him before the people after Passover. Peter was therefore kept in prison. But constant prayer, everyone say constant prayer. Constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. Thank God for a praying church. Today, oh, Peter's in jail. Oh, darn, I'm sure I'm going to miss him Sunday morning. Man, listen, we got to learn to pray for people, amen? They're going through trials and tribulations. We are the body of Christ. We need to stand together. We need to pray and intercede until that thing is broken off people's lives. Amen? Be it physical bondages or physical sickness or disease or whatever it is. And when Herod, that was the king who had Peter arrested, was about to bring him out, That night, Peter was sleeping, bound with two chains between two soldiers. So I want you to picture this. He's in a jail cell. He's got chains on his legs, chains on his feet, and those chains are attached to soldiers on both sides of him. And there's four squads of soldiers just outside the prison door. That was how much Herod was determined to keep Peter in prison. But how many of you know that God, if he has a different plan for your life, it's going to happen, amen? So let's see what happened. Now behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison, and he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Arise quickly." You guys ever have a hard time waking your kids up? They're dead asleep, and you're like, "Wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up." Or am I the only parent ever had that problem? Listen, or maybe sometimes our spouse, they just won't wake up. So Peter's dead asleep, an angel of God comes and hits him on the side. "Wake up, arise quickly." And literally the translation is, "Get up, wake yourself up, get up, hurry." Then the angel said to him, "Gird yourself, tie on your sandals." And so he did. You ever get in such a hurry that you just forget your shoes? Or you're so tired? Listen, I got to tell myself, I've just had a blonde moment after blonde moment this week. Yesterday, I was on my way to the gym, and I had my workout shorts on, my workout shirt, and I walk outside to my car. I'm about to get in my car. I look down, and I'm wearing my house slippers with bare feet. So I go back and walk in, and I tell my wife, I said, "Look how I'm dressed." And so I had to go put on some shoes. So here the angel's like, "Peter, grab your shoes." So he did. And he said to him, "Put on your garment and follow me." Now listen, the only thing I can think is, Peter, have you ever just woken up and you're so tired and you're kind of in that in and out stage of sleep and you're just, is this real or is this a dream? That's how Peter was. It says in verse 9, "So he went out and followed him and did not know that what was done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing what? Thought he was having a dream, seeing a vision. When they were past the first and second guard posts," remember there's four squads, "they came to the iron gate that leads to the city, which opened to them of its own accord. And they went out and went down one street, and immediately the angel departed from them." I love this story. Why? Listen, the Holy Spirit could have woken Peter up. The Holy Spirit could have broke the chains off of him, like he did with Paul and Titus. But God, in this instance, chose to use what? Chose to use an angel. And it just cracks me up because the angel's like, "Wake up, Peter. Don't forget your shoes. Put on your clothes." And he's just, Peter's like, "Oh, okay. Follow me." And now listen, he's chained to two soldiers. Those chains drop off. Those soldiers had to have been fast asleep. All four squads of soldiers were out cold. I think that the Holy Spirit knocked them out, or the angel knocked them out. And now Peter is free, and he's like just waking up and realizing, this is real, I'm really free. And the angel even walks him until he gets to the right street and says, okay. Then the angel takes off. Now look at what happens to the rest of the story. In Acts chapter 12, verse 13, "And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a girl named Rhoda came to answer. When she recognized Peter's voice because of her gladness, she didn't open the gate. She leaves Peter outside the gate. He knocks to get in. She was so excited, it's Peter. She forgot to unlock the gate and let him in. She runs in and announces that Peter stood before the gate." Now remember, the church, when they heard Peter was arrested, what did they do? They prayed. Everybody say they prayed. Constant prayer. It wasn't this, "Oh God, free Peter in Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys, we'll see you next Sunday at..." No, they were in constant, they were still praying. They were still having prayer meeting. They were showing perseverance in their prayer. But they said to her, "You're beside yourself." So Rhoda, she's like, "Hey guys, Peter's outside the gate." They're like, you've lost your mind. What are you talking about? Now understand, you're sitting there praying for Peter's release. A little girl comes and says, Peter's right outside the gate. And they're like, sorry, I don't believe you. Yet she kept insisting that it was so. So now they said, well, it's not really Peter. That must be his angel. That's the angel who guards Peter is outside. Now, why in the world the angel would be there if Peter was in the prison? But who knows? All I know is they're praying for Peter's release, thank God. But then Peter's released and nobody believes her. Now, Peter continued knocking. That's pretty funny. And when they opened the door and saw him, they were what? They were astonished. Everybody say astonished. Listen, guys. What God does for one, he'll do for others. The Bible says God is no respecter of persons. He doesn't love people unequally. He loves you just as much as he loves the person next to you, just as much as he loves Peter, just as much as he loves me. Learn to have faith in what the Word of God says. Let it be the foundation for your life. And the Scripture instructs us that these angelic angels of God have been sent to help you and I, to guard us, to protect us, and so much more. Amen? Learn to take God at His word. I'm like, Lord, why is it so many people in America never have angelic visits anymore? He said the same thing and the same reason that most people don't see what the Scripture says they should be seeing, actually see, because we hear it with our mind, but we don't actually believe any of this stuff. It's all about head knowledge. God wants to get from your brain to your heart. Amen? Brain to your heart. Let's all stand to our feet. A declaration of faith as we close out in prayer. Now, for those of you who are new, what we do is we have every Sunday morning as we close out a time where you just repeat this prayer after me and we're just going to believe God to answer. Heavenly Father, we decree that God's heaven, Holy Spirit, and His angels, in partnership with the believing church, will now work together in the greatest mission of the church in all time. The young and the old will participate together. We loose the angel, the angel armies, to assist a new Jesus movement. Heavenly Father, send the angels who strengthen your church and your people in Jesus' mighty name. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed, remain standing. If you're here this morning and you would like one day very much to have that surety in your heart that you're going to step into the eternity of heaven, and maybe you've never surrendered your life to Jesus, or maybe you prayed a prayer at one time, but you know in your heart that you need to make a full, wholehearted commitment to Him of your life. If that's you with no one looking around and you need to surrender your life to Jesus, right here, God the Father says, today is the day, now is the time. If that's you, lift your hand to the Lord, say, Jesus, that's me. I need Jesus to be Lord of my life today. Hallelujah, Lord. Glory to God. Saints praying around the room. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Amen.